Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and a warm welcome to the Year 7 Certificate of Achievement Evening. It's your first one of these, and I'm sure it's been said to you way back when, whenever you came in for your welcome evening in June of last year. If you're having your first COA evening, you said, well, it's a long time away. Here it is. And there are four more, only four more, and then they can leave. So I want you to ponder on that one. They've had a successful year, and we're extremely pleased with Year 7. Seems to me like only yesterday when I was confronted with 1,300 application forms, and they covered every space in my office. They went out the door, into my secretary's office, round the walls of her office, and out her door. And I got a wallpaper table to spread them out on, try and cope with all of these forms. And that 1,300 application forms resulted in this 180 boys and girls who are here this evening. And I'm delighted that we asked every single one of them to come to Harris CTC because they've had a fabulous year. And the purpose of this evening is for us to celebrate their success, and they have been a great success. But what an exciting time to be at Harris. On the small scale excitement, we're introducing blazers in every year group except year 11 from September. And the vast majority of these students have already organised their blazers. But there's a handful who haven't. I would not want to be a student turning up in a school with 1,100 students in blazers without one in September. So if you haven't done anything about it, you have a few working days left to get it sorted out. More exciting than that is, of course, the news of our academy conversion, and we become an academy in September 2007, 12 months away. Well, it's a change of name. But with it comes £10 million of investment. And in 18 months' time, we'll start to build the new post-16 block. And we'll offer a phenomenal range of courses, and even better facilities than we offer now. So these students will be part of the new Harris Academy Post-16, and we're looking forward to being able to offer them the most fantastic sixth form provision around. We'll also be introducing new facilities for music and drama. So hopefully by the time they take their GCSE options, those subjects should be on offer. So a good school becoming an even better school, and these students are here at the beginning and will benefit from all of that. Without further ado, and before you melt, I'd now like to hand back to the head of faculty who will introduce our very talented and very brave compeers for this evening. It's only 11 or 12.
As Dr. Monaghan said, we have students who are actually going to compare the evening rather than me getting up on stage every now and again. So I'd like to invite Alexander and Cassandra up on stage. Let's give them a round of applause.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our Year 7 COA. My name is Cassandra, and I'm in the communications faculty. My name is Alexandra, and I'm in the technology faculty. When I walked into Harris, I was a bit shy.
Don't worry, just carry on, don't worry.
We would like to welcome Arlene Small.
Thank you.
people, but I was quite excited to fresh start. I find it hard to believe that we have been at Harris for nearly a whole academic year. My first day was great, the school was big, I got lost a few times, but before long I started making friends and enjoying myself. Before starting my first day at Harris, I was extremely nervous. It was a whole new life. What would my tutoring classmates be like? Would I like them? And would I be able to find my way around school? Thankfully, I like my tutor. My classmates are great, and I have only got lost twice. In Harris so far, I've had exciting journeys. Before I came to Harris, I couldn't speak French. I couldn't say bonjour, je m'appelle Sandra, et au revoir. But now I can speak a second language, slightly.
Once the first day was out of the way, I found it easy to adjust to life at Harris. I even managed to keep up with the homework.
Before long it was Christmas, I couldn't believe it. 4 months had passed so quickly. By this time, I really felt part of school.
On the 28th of June, we went on a trip to France for the day. It was a great day out, and we had a laugh. I managed to buy some great bling in the French market. This was a great chance for us to speak some French.
I visited the church up the road and Rochester, where I've learned historical values of buildings and saw Christianity for R&D.
My personal highlight of my time at Harris has been making the football team. I am the goalkeeper. The team had a fantastic season. We won the league without losing the game and went on to win the Croydon Cup at Croydon Arena. You can all see the benefits of a fantastic goalkeeper.
During the year, I've made achievements and set targets. I know that Harris isn't just for someone with brains to get straight A's. It's a school for achieving and doing the best you can to be the best you are in everything.
I think we would all agree that we have had a great first year at Harris. Thank you for listening.
That was an interesting time for me. There were approximately three of us and we would go around and harass children who we thought were not part of the inner crowd. This went on for quite a long while as I was growing up. My mum was absolutely desperate. What are we going to do with her? Well, the teachers knew what to do with me, and they probably expelled me from my school. At that point, my mum was really desperate and wondered how on earth am I going to get this child educated? Is she going to end up in prison? You know, all the usual parent concern that you have for a child that's rebellious and out of control. At some point, I had to make a choice. Unfortunately, some of those choices were made for me, in as much as my mother got to the point where she could no longer cope with me misbehaving, and she sent me to live with an alternative family, which is called a foster family. I don't know how many people here or how many of the youngsters here are aware of that as a term. But that's where I ended up, in a foster family, and placed with somebody who wasn't my biological mother, but who had undertaken the task to look out for me. Now, at that stage, I still had many opportunities to express my youthfulness. I was very mouthy, which is probably why I ended up being a barrister, but I was extremely mouthy and answered back a lot of the time, and really wasn't interested in anything that anybody had to say. And I remember I went to a Catholic school, which was run by nuns and priests, and it was quite strict. And I remember one of the nuns shaking her head in despair at me and saying, you know, if you carry on like this, you will end up in prison. Very encouraging words, you might imagine, for a 13-year-old, but, you know, I still wanted to do my own thing. There did come a point, though, I grew up at around 16 years of age. I was, exited, if you like, from care, and I ended up in a 16-plus project for young girls. And effectively, again, it was a gateway into a lifestyle that I wanted to lead. I could have got involved with boys, with drugs, with whatever, really, because there wasn't anybody there exercising any parental control. And at that point, I had to really ask myself, what kind of life did I want? What kind of future did I want for myself? And somewhere along the light was switched on. Now, I pause there because, as I said at the start, success is a choice, and life is full of choices. You're out to year seven now, but as you get on, you'll find more and more things, opportunities coming your way. At the moment, for example, when wearing a uniform in school, there'll come a point where you have to decide whether you're going to, well, not continue to wear the uniform, but what kind of clothes you want to wear on your days when you're not in school. That may be, I don't know, an England shirt, despite how bad they did in the World Cup, or there might be some other outfit that you quite fancy putting on. There's those kinds of simple choices. There's choices as you get older in terms of your career, whether you want to become a lawyer or a doctor or something else. There are even choices about what we eat, and I know that there has been a huge campaign, you're probably tired of hearing about this, about Jamie Oliver and about the choices for children in schools. But we know that there are consequences to the choices that we make. And that's really the point that I found myself at, that there really was a consequence of the decisions that I was making. So the lights switched on, and I don't know what it's going to take. There may be some of you sitting here who feel that you haven't done as well as you wanted to do in your first year. There may be some of you who are sitting here thinking, I really messed up on that test, or I haven't worked as hard as I should have done, I haven't got the grade that I should have done, or I spent too long messing about with my friends, talking at the back of the class, not handing in my homework. And you may be thinking, well, I've made the choice, the consequences of that are I'm not going to do well anymore. Well, I'm here to tell you that's simply not true. I made some absolutely atrocious choices as a youngster, absolutely abysmal. In fact, given that I've got 7 or 10 minutes or whatever it is, I'm actually quite glad, because if I was to tell you anything, I'm sure your parents would be rushing forward and moving you from the front rows, because it really is a shocking tale. But I've summed it down just to let you know that effectively you can make changes to turn whatever situation you're in around. Sometimes the choices that you have may be limited by your current circumstances, whether that be because you're brought up in a single parent home and you feel that that's a problem, or because there's not enough money around and that's a problem, or you live in the wrong area and that's a problem. Again, I had all of those things. I'm a single parent, working class, no money to speak of, I can assure you, despite what you read in the newspapers. Those kinds of, that was my background, and effectively, I have had opportunities given to me that I took and decided that I wanted to make changes in my life. If you believe that your choices are limited by your circumstances, whether they be past or present ones, then you've already limited yourself in the things that you want to achieve. You almost have to draw a line under where you are coming from, where your home life is, what your background is, and make a decision. As I said, success is a choice. Take responsibility for the choices that you make. If you know, for example, that you have a friend that constantly talks to you in class, that constantly distracts you, that's always passing you notes when you should be concentrating on your homework, perhaps you need to make a choice to sit somewhere else. So that if the teacher asks you, why have you done your work, rather than say, miss it was her, or miss it was him, say that actually I should have done something about that. That's what it means to make a choice. Make a choice and choose success. Or perhaps you're getting up in the morning, getting ready for school, and your parent is saying to you, hurry up, get downstairs, come down for breakfast or whatever it is, or maybe you're rushing to get your own breakfast, and you are exhausted. Not because you didn't have the opportunity to sleep, but because you chose not to sleep. I don't know how many young people here have mobile phones, but I do know that they seem to be permanently clamped to people's ears at 12, 1, 2, 3 in the morning. If that's you, perhaps the choice should be to put down the mobile phone, to go to bed, knowing that you've got a full day of school ahead of you in the morning. The choice is yours to choose success. In both of those examples, the consequences are following through from your own decisions, from your own choices. So what will your choice be? Will it be to be lazy? Will you choose to be mediocre, which basically means not achieving too much? Will you choose to just be a follower in the crowd? Or will you choose to be an achiever? Will you choose to be hardworking? Will you choose to accomplish something? Will you choose to be a success? Take every opportunity that's given to you. Don't mess about with your chances. It's easy to think, well, I'm young, I've got my life ahead. You know, I might be singing one day, someone will discover me and I'll end up really rich like Christina Aguilera. That may not happen to you. If that's not your gift, then you may need to think about working hard on something else. So don't waste your choices, don't waste your opportunities. The things that I'm saying are not just things that I've made up or thought about just this morning. That has been my life experience. I have not had the opportunity to have the parental support that a lot of you have here looking around this room. And yes, that was my choice. I chose not to listen. I chose not to be rebellious. And I chose not to take guidance from those around me. You have that here, you have that opportunity now. But my life was very different. Just as the compare was showing you, what I've managed to achieve has been about the choice that I've made. It was 7 long years of study and of sacrifice and of hard work, but nobody could do that for me. I had to make a decision that that's what I wanted to do with my life, and I followed through. So my invitation to you really in closing is to choose success. Make the most of every opportunity to work hard, to take guidance from your parents and from your teachers, and ultimately I can promise you that you will achieve your goals. Thank you very much.
Runges, Gods, and One of These. Individuality is independently standing on your own, to be unique and not a clone. The five of me, please, chaps, grinders, goths, and wannabes. I'm so puzzled, tell me, what are these? Are they just individuals trying to make a point of being unique or pass the joint? Group or crowds look the same, but to any of us it serves as a called a name. So, you go into the market and you find what you get. Fake designer, let alone you, it's not quite so dear. There's a laughter I know, the paint size black, puts on dark clothes and wears a rucksack. My name, she's a ranger, I'm proud of it too. So what, who cares, it could be me, it could be you. Doesn't mean I'd rather be their friends, and if they've got a problem, why are they can bend? Then there's the wannabes that always report in their tracking box of night bags playing our B-songs. You all came to school because we're unique in our own individual ways, for ourselves we can speak. So rather than categorise ourselves and stand in small groups, bend the peer pressure on each other we snoop. We bitch, we criticise anyone who's in my class. Frankly, I can't see why the fuss. Individuality is independently standing on your own, to be unique and not a clone. Define for me, please, chaps, grinders, goths, and wannabes. I'm so puzzled, tell me, what are these?
Thank you. Thank you. The other thing that we say is a very difficult joy to choose one person from the group. And every chairman is strictly special in their own way. But we did have to choose one person. And the student I've chosen is a student that always has to be uniform and attitude. He's helpful, able to work with others. And I've chosen the award to go to Nathan Larkin. The other members of 7SB, James Campbell, Romain Carter, Daniel Schubert, Rosie Dolphin, Wendy Dolphin, Lauren Gordon, Elizabeth Dolphin, Matilda Hunt, Stephen Johnson, Stephen Kennedy, Ethan Martin, Christopher Roman, Kevin Johnson,
Thank you. He's never had any intentions, as far as I know, or bracelets. He's very polite, and the award goes to Andrew Knott.
The next award is for
their work, they constantly put in 100% effort into both classwork and presentation. I have been impressed with her verbal ability in class, writes the teacher. She has good understanding of geographical concepts that have been studied this year. Well done. The award goes to Amy Mantoni.
Is the Lowell Benjamin Award. Many of you will know Lowell Benjamin. She's golden gift. And when I saw I worked really hard, and in fact I worked hard all my life, and just recently, living in our family, Chancellor of the University of Exeter, and I hope that one day I'm going to welcome some future university. Between them, you have got to work hard to see. And every year, I think I have a learner and an achievement in some of these hard, and I can tell most of you both very, very hard. Those of you who haven't, but this year, this someone is in quite an exception. She's talented, she's responsible, and she's an unusual creator. She's very creative, both artistically and musically, and she's a joy to teach. I've been told she always has a smile on her face, and in the end, she looks so very good. I wonder if that person knows who she is. Well, I'm very proud to announce that the Global Energy Award for 2006 goes to
thank you.
finally, Pauline for coming to them.
Most of the stuff we see on TV in the Eurovision contest. So well done to Year 7 for singing in French in public. Thanks to a lot of people, but particularly to Arlene Small. Arlene told you a disturbing story, a story of a youngster gone wrong at an early age. And from that adversity, through determination and the choices that she made, the desire to be a winner, to be successful, she's made it and is on the way to making it. All of you are in a different situation. You're in a great school. You're not being excluded. You're behaving well. You've got good relationships with your parents. You've got every reason to be successful. So if Arlene can do it, the message is that you can do it too. And who knows what you can achieve in 10 years' time.